happening. No, I just started mentioning this, of course, was a unique experience to us. I think that kind of experience has never been had by any black metal band before. Performing at the opera house with the opera choir there, and with a specially written arrangement for the entire show. And it's that kind of thing that you will, as an artist, remember for your entire life. We felt that it was something that Satyricon was very ready for, and an undertaking that suited the band very well, and something that we could learn a lot from, and something that would give us and listeners a huge and fantastic experience. And also it was about creating a piece of art. I mean, we performed a piece of music that has never been performed before, neither before or since. So the only recording that has ever been done of this particularly written work was that very show. You might refer to a play that has had some actors from the scene here, or at least one, but kind of black metal musical I've never heard about. And that would still be something very, very different, because what we did had nothing to do with any kind of musical, and it was a far greater seriousness to it than that. And exactly that is something that that the opera performance was a lot about, you know, the grand and the solemn and the ceremonial. We felt that in the opera house and with the choir performing with us, we could uplift something that exists in Satyricon music from before, but give it an even larger emphasis and an even larger room, and make it come forth a little stronger. And that is also exactly what I experienced when we did perform, that Satyricon has never felt that grand and ceremonial as we did with the opera choir that night at the opera house. And I'm very glad that we could be there and experience it and see how we created this very electrical interaction with the audience, and also, you know, what went on between the choir and the band. It was really magical and electrical, and that kind of experience that Satyricon is a lot about. Something that that stands out, and something that takes a lot to put up, but that we can still manage to pull off in a way that feels very Satyricon-esque. Yeah, we did a few rehearsals at the smaller stage at the Opera House sometime before the show happened. So I think it was talk about, you know, a few days of rehearsals with the choir in order to secure that the band was 100% confident with the arrangements that were made, and in order for the band and the choir to really perform together, because that is still important. Even if there's a professional choir singing with us, you have to do a little work and some preparations to create that togetherness that bands are all about. And since the songs are Satyricon songs, the material is specially written for us, we also have to make sure that we feel fine about everything that is being written. And, you know, if there was felt necessity to change or improve anything, there was a chance for us to do it. But by and large, you know, all those arrangements worked very, very fine, and those adjustments that we do were a few ones only. Still, they were quite important. We have wanted to do something along those lines for quite some time. But the real start of the project was in early 2012 when Satyricon were actually invited to do a special performance of one song together with the opera choir at the Opera House. And we decided to say yes to that challenge since we saw that there was some kind of potential in that teamwork and that it would be very interesting to see how a choir could work with Satyricon and how choral arrangements could be written to suit Satyricon's music. But luckily the guy that brought the arrangements had a very good hand with it, and he understood Satyricon's music and the potential of the cooperation very well, and also the director of the choir or the conductor of the choir did a very, very good job making the choir and the band become synchronized. So after that one experience in 2012, we felt that this was so great and so fascinating to do that we definitely wanted to put up a full show with the choir at the Opera House. We could create true magic that way. It started, you know, a year and a half of work that luckily ended up with the concert taking place and becoming exactly what we had hoped for it to be. Okay, I'm glad that you like those things, and as you probably can tell, we ourselves, you know, become inspired by that kind of events, and it was the kind of inspirations that we brought with us when we went on that European tour that you're referring to, and you know, on which that London show also was part. I think you're right with it being quite different from anything we've done before. And then I guess every Satyricon album is quite unique and different from all the others. I think what really set the last two albums apart from the previous ones, and which was also the reason that we wanted to name an album after the band itself after almost 20 years, was that there was so much dynamics entering the music, and the album has a strong sense of autumn and autumnal colors, I feel, even if there's, you know, also colder bits and darker bits. You know, those earthy autumnal colors felt very fitting for the album. It also felt very important for us to kind of express that on the album, to do something that is a little unconventional and perhaps, you know, for this rather narrow genre, a little bold and daring. Well, is it about, you know, trying to reflect the music and the general mood of the album itself? And since there is, you know, a larger set of dynamics and more a sense of, you know, night and day and light and darkness and, you know, a journey through more vivid musical landscapes, that really needed to be reflected in a larger color palette on the front cover of the album. We definitely felt that. What is really important to point out when commenting on lyrics is lyrics are personal works and definitely poems. when it comes to just those lyrics, which are written for Phoenix, those are written by Steve Italian, who sings them.
Yes.
Which we also meant was very important, and it's definitely a Satyricon song, but we wanted to have his vocals and his added presence and character expressed through those vocals on this. We were convinced that his own quite different kind of dark musical expression would sound beautiful with Satyricon, and that we could write a song that would make Sievert's vocals shine and perhaps feel even more impressive than they do in his own project, at least the way we would understand it. And he was very happy to do it because he likes Satyricon a lot, and he has a certain fondness for Norwegian black metal and its vibe and spirit, at least those bands that he truly enjoy. Satyricon being one of those. But if we were to write a song for him, he should also write lyrics for the song. Because what he performs should be something personal to him, something that he could do with the uttermost conviction, and something that he could carry out, you know, with that kind of passion and soulfulness that you do when you sing your own work. And hence, there is only him that really can tell you the references and the meanings of things. I mean, I could interpret them just the way you could. And I think that perhaps the symbolism and the metaphors aren't really that difficult. He felt that, you know, the subject of resurrection and going through that passage and rise with enormous strength after that passage had been done, you know, after the crossing had been done. That is what he felt was right for the lyrics. And we felt that what he said about it and what he wrote was really meaningful, and when he sang it, it all made sense, you know. So there were definitely no objections from our side when it came to semantics or the lyrics themselves. He understood how to write lyrics for such a song, but I cannot really tell you anything more what they're truly about, and you could yourself, your own interpretation would be as good as mine, if you get it.
Yes.
Band doesn't really have the final answer here. You would have to talk to Sievert himself if you wanted to hear his interpretation of his own words and, you know, what he truly meant by all of it. But I think it comes for us in a clear enough fashion, so. Yeah, thoughts on this matter, you would need a book to really explain to their full extent, and, you know, it's beyond the scope of a simple answer in an interview to explain Satyricon's thoughts and the band philosophy on those matters completely. I mean, what it comes down to, by and large, is that there has always been a strong despite of the stupidity of institutionalized religion, in this band. It has been like that from the very start, and that is still correct. Both Satyr and I share the opinion that religion makes people more stupid than they need to be. It prevents a healthy evolution. It brings very, very unhealthy principles to the societies where the religions flourish and become denominators. And it really brings out the worst in people, which is very, very evident these days. I mean, religions are really made by humans to serve as moral guides and denominators for the collective societies of people. I mean, it is inherent in any kind of institutionalized religion that power of those that are believed to be in communication with whatever god is the foundation for a specific religion. Well, those people will have a power that no man should really have. I think it's so enormously evident that religions are human-made structures made to serve human purposes and to meet human demands. And failing to see that they are basically advanced fairy tales. It's very hard to understand and cannot be said to be anything but stupidity. And also, you know, the thought that the ethics and the morality of a society is to be decided by what's written in the book, and perhaps furthermore even by how certain humans interpret what's written in the book. It's both stupid and dangerous and utterly irrational, and we oppose it with everything we have. I mean, it is our feeling that as humans we have potential to find truths for ourselves and to be individuals that can, as individuals with our own truths, also reach far and have an enormous impact, but really without, you know, telling other people what their ways need to be. To find one's own way must always be the leading star, and that's really one of the foundations of value that we have, and that must necessarily come in deep conflict with any kind of religion. And then it's much easier to have a certain sympathy for codexes that are much closer to nature and the true spirit of man. And if we look into certain old codexes that we had here before Christianity came from abroad and was forced upon the country, we see a set of beliefs that were much more cut out to explain what at that point wasn't really explained, and to deal with the complexity that humans and the human mind necessarily will have to encounter, and which seems to try to build humans to become their very best, rather than becoming stupid sheep that are to follow one particular way. Because how paganism was here, for instance, was very different, and it was very far from being monotheistic, for instance. So it really mirrored a much more true and complex understanding of man in a time where we still didn't have science, and where a lot of what is today explained to us through science wasn't explained at all, but was still something that we needed to relate to, like that being natural phenomena or other complex elements in our surroundings, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that was half the book already. Most of us that have somehow ended up in black metal and devoted a lot of our lives to have done it for spiritual reasons, and that's how it was with us. So we are working a lot. We have so much material that we don't really know what to do with it. But
okay.
As for now, we're in the process where we really work on songs rather than just having jam sessions. But we have this far in the process found, you know, the jam format to work really well for us. We gather in the rehearsal place. Sometimes we do have specific plans of what we are to do and what to work with. Other times we give ourselves the freedom to, you know, just do jams, and we could play low key music for half an hour or even 2 hours, and perhaps understand that possibly what we have been doing will not end up on the album, but still, you know, we work with music, and we work with spirit, and sometimes, you know, we get so inspired just by jamming that something brilliant comes out of it, and suddenly we have the key parts for a song already there. But these days we have reached so far that we have started to see what is to become songs, and what are just, you know, good pieces of music that we have been playing on these jams, but that will probably not be ending up on the album. And you know, we try to narrow everything down and start to do some true decision making. We have been doing demo recordings several times, and at this point we start to feel what the album is going to be about, I think, and we see it's going to be very creative, very varied, and even more dynamic and vivid than the previous album, and there will be a really, really vast spectrum of vibes and feelings and energies and atmospheres on the album. But I know it's going to sound very, very inspired and very, very